MB Jairam, National President, Dr. T. Vinay Kumar, our zonal chairmen, and all our friends here, national executives from all over India, chapter chairpersons, and our PR fraternity here. A warm welcome to Uma Sudhir, Executive Director, NDTV, Mahua Gorti, Transformational Coach and Author, Taruna Taurani, Celebrity Anchor, Danish Kanagaraj, Motivational Coach. Thank you so much for being with us today. See, the Young Communicators Club is the youth wing of Public Relations Council of India, and it is progressing, I would say, in leaps and bounds and bringing in a lot of transformational energy. The E factor, the energy factor, is very much prevalent here. YCC represents the student community from all fields of society under a single non-political and a non-governmental umbrella. And to help students to communicate effectively and also regularly with purpose and responsibility for a better society. And we also, through YCC, we try to bring in accountability in leadership and help each other to become good and responsible citizens of the country. And that is, in short, about Young Communicators Club. Well, this topic, communication in the world of convergence, is really illuminating. Communications, is a combination of ethos, pathos, and logos. Opening a bank account, emotional bank account, is ethos. Pathos is building relationship, and logos is the logical or the analytical part in communication. And now, with the convergence, where there is a sort of integrated knowledge, tools, etc., and communicating, thinking from all fields, like right from life and health sciences to the humanities, the arts, the physical, mathematical, computational sciences, everything. All of them put together is a convergence. And we are going to tackle all the scientific and the societal challenges which are going to happen that exist in multiple fields. And by all these diverse areas of expertise, my dear friends, we are able to bring in innovative and practical applications. In fact, today the chief, the panelists are also, there's a convergence of different minds, different brains. And here we are all together going to talk about communication leading to convergence. Well, thank you so much. And it's a D-Day, especially in the history of Young Communicators Club. The Hyderabad has started its first programs. Great luck to you guys. And looking forward to many such programs, and a warm welcome to all of you. Thank you so much. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Geeta ma'am, for those kind words. And also thank you for introducing YCC to our new members who've joined the webinar today. So without any delay, I would like to take you all forward in today's program. So just as a note of getting you all accustomed with the topic, I'd like to say communication in today's context has grown multifold, and it has assumed a greater importance and significance. Of course, we have a set of brilliant speakers lined up who will be speaking in depth about the topic. But just to start with off, in today's world, we see that there is a lot of non-mediated communication has because of COVID and because of the restrictions, non-mediated communication is fading. And all we see that communication is happening in the mediated world through many different sources. And so it is essential that we learn to disseminate our messages through these various channels without the essence of our message being lost and the meaning carried without the message being distorted. So in today's webinar, we will learn how to cope up with the various communication channels from our journalism teachers, Mrs. Uma and Mrs. Taruna, and also from Mrs. Mahua and Mr. Danish. We will learn how to keep our spirits and minds active while being bombarded with this bulky information cannons that we are seeing in today's world. So without delay, I would now like to request our Hyderabad PRCI chairperson, Ms. Anandita Sinha, to introduce the first speaker of the day, and Ms. Uma Sudhir ma'am will then take over.
Hi
Good evening, everyone. Welcome, of course, I can see Chairman Emeritus and everyone from the National Council and Zonal Council. Now, just to save time, what we have done is we have shared the profile of the speakers with everyone because they are so long, huge, and their feet are just difficult to cover in a short while. So that is the reason we have circulated the profiles of everyone. And I'm really privileged and honored to have all the speakers today in this first webinar of YCC. And I'm just introducing because I have to play some part as a chairperson. Otherwise, everything I leave it to YCC to do the young girls, and they will do fantastic. Welcome, Miss Uma Sudhir. Now, Mrs. Uma Sudhir, it's so difficult to say because she is just Uma to me, a very, very good friend. And me describing Uma or telling anything about Uma, no, I don't think I am that knowledgeable. I just go spellbound. In fact, I remember one of the time I just called her and said, "Ke Uma, please be careful. You're reporting in this time, difficult time, whether it's COVID, whether it's cyclone, whether it's Chennai, you will find Uma there, the executive director of NDTV there, and field reporting is something her passion, I guess. Otherwise, she can comfortably take a very good office work and just do the leadership from there. But anyway, we all know Uma. So from Uma, what we are going to get today is the professionals. Of course, we are also learning is a never-ending process to learn how communication is and what is the message for the youngsters to do her life experience, her case studies. Uma, 15 minutes is just something. You please don't bother about time. We would love to speak to you. Welcome on the session, Uma. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Anindita. And good to have a friend there who will say all nice things about you. So lovely there. Thank you, Shonya. And thank you, Geeta ma'am. And hi, everyone else. Many of you I do know. In one way or the other, we would have met, and otherwise glad to meet as well. Thank you, first of all, for having me here, and it's a pleasure. Franya, what she's done for me is to actually give me a framework, and that sounds like such a professional job she has done, because instead of having very basic questions, she has made it into something that is very current and very topical, and that shows that she herself is very well versed with what is happening in the world of media. Today we are doing Teachers Day, and I think one of the best things about journalism and being in this media for all young people, I would say, is that this allows you to continuously learn. And one of the good things is you ask the questions, you don't have to provide the answers. So everywhere you can go and you can ask those questions and people will tell you the answers. There's one of the very popular movies of Kamal Haasan, and there's an actor called Nagesh. They say, கேள்வி கேட்கறது ரொம்ப சுலபம், ஆன்சர்ஸ் சொல்றது தான் முஷ்கில் கைண்ட் ஆஃப் திங். ஸோ தட்ஸ் த சேம் திங். ஸோ வி ஆர் இன் த ப்ரிவிலேஜ் பொசிஷன் வேர் வி கேன் ஆஸ்க் தோஸ் க்வெஸ்சன்ஸ். தி ஐடியா இஸ் தட் இஃப் யூ ஆர் ஆஸ்கிங் தோஸ் க்வெஸ்சன்ஸ், வாட் ஆர் த கைண்ட் ஆஃப் க்வெஸ்சன்ஸ் தட் யூ ஆர் ஆஸ்கிங் விச் வில் கெட் யூ த ரைட் ஆன்சர்ஸ். தட் பர்ஹாப்ஸ் இஸ் த ஸ்கில் தட் வி லேர்ன். அண்ட் த்ரூ தட், த ஃபேக்ட் தட் you will remain a student all your life because you will get an opportunity to learn every single day, and that continues. And that it's one thing that keeps you on your toes all the time, and that's perhaps the best part of being a journalist in these times, that you can communicate with anyone, ask anyone the questions. Nobody will charge you a fee for it, for that matter, and you can get away with getting all the answers. Journalism in the times of COVID has very much changed. Even otherwise, we've been talking about a very convergence newsroom. There was a time when spent about 10 years in the Times of India and the Economic Times, that means the print medium, literally. Almost 10 years I spent, I was with Times of India and Delhi and Economic Times as well. And that's when I shifted to the television, when the first 24-hour news channel happened in India, which was called Star News 24/7. It was on the Star platform that NDTV was doing the news. And from then onwards to now, I would say, people thought that when television came, newspapers will die. That did not happen. When newspapers continued to survive and evolved. Similarly, when television came after newspapers, both of them were there together. Now digital has come, and you are realizing that all three are coexisting. Much more importantly, not even coexisting, convergence which has been a word that's very often used. Convergence is the way all newsrooms are working. And therefore, even though many people know me as a television journalist, actually 70 to 80% of my work happens in the digital medium, which is actually print medium, digital medium are in a sense similar to some extent, except that, you know, print medium, you had the deadlines were a little more relaxed, but now it is not the case even for print media people because they have to keep up with their web versions and they have to also do the same breaking news. They may not be on TV, but they also need to do on social media, on the handles given to them by their offices. So all our media newsrooms are looking very similar. They are convergence newsrooms and you are doing the work of a reporter, you're doing the work of a camera person, you're doing the work of an editor, and very often you're posting it also. You're the producer of that entire news cycle, which is happening as well. And all the time being very, very careful about what can, because the responsibility is on you. There's going to be very little gatekeeping when you start, when you are posting it yourself. And therefore, that is something. So I'm going to go with the cues that Trania has given me. With reportage becoming virtual more than live, how is the newsroom evolving to cope today's challenges? First of all, the newsroom increasingly, because there is no money with any of the media channels, and channels like NDTV are quite the favorite of the government, as many of you know, and therefore we have even less money than most others do, and we don't get advertisements. We are not advertisements are banned from our channel, even though many corporates do like us, and politicians also privately will tell you that we watch NDTV for unbiased news or whatever. That's something that's an aside, but beyond that, what is happening is because the resources are so limited and because we are living in a COVID environment, that earlier, what we used to do in earlier times about going out and reporting, that is getting increasingly decreased, compromised, and therefore that kind of field reporting you're not seeing. Even otherwise, television evolved. You had a new, should I say, demigod of television who is now asking you all the questions about give me the drugs, whatever. I'm not going to take his name, but that person redefined the way news is done, and therefore it got limited to studios in many ways and not going out into the field, and you're not getting the field experiences per se. So 2-3 things are happening there. One, that all these newsrooms have all evolved for everyone. I used to be a 10-member bureau just in Hyderabad. Now I am 2-member bureau in Hyderabad. That's the kind of thing that cost will do to you. And therefore you start co-opting everyone within your family to help you. My father was 83. He would sometimes do my camera work. My daughter would do my camera work. My watchman would do my camera work. Now I do it all myself. Of course, I've learned the trick of using the selfie stick and doing it yourself. And you're doing the same live thing that you would do earlier with a huge OB van and broadcast van and about 10 people as a crew and so on and so forth. Now one person does everything. Only thing is the pressure of all that falling on one person will mean that the quality and the depth of the news which is there is going to get limited to that extent. The second important thing is that now from the print to the digital, now because we have a social media in which everyone is active, our sources of news has become so much more. Twitter, Facebook, or whatever else. The Insta is much more bigger in many senses. All those have become very important channels for getting the news itself. And everybody has become a communicator. And that's why you as professionals, how are you going to distinguish yourself in this particular field when everyone has the same kind of a camera, has this access to the similar information everywhere, because when some breaking news now happens, everyone has access to the same kind of information. How are you going to make it your differentiating factor? That is where your role as a journalist will come. Journalism, why is it different from other kinds of things where everybody is using WhatsApp, everyone's using Facebook, everyone's using Twitter? What is the difference that a journalist brings? We believe that we are doing some kind of a gatekeeping. And we also believe that we are the traditional value system of a news organization, that you will have unbiased news, you will have both sides of the news story, and you will allow your reader or your audience to make the choice about what is right and what their opinion could be and what they would agree with and what they may not agree with, without trying to impose only one viewpoint. And much more importantly is that gatekeeping, which will ensure that false news doesn't go in that. So if you are planning to build your career as news journalist, I would say this is perhaps the best time, because in many ways you are able to build your own profiles on your different social media handles. Use them very responsibly, use them in a very interesting, relevant manner, and think of yourself as professionals in the future who will be able to, for that you must start thinking about your profile and how you want to use your social media handle in the most responsible manner. Don't give in to the temptation of someone forwarding you something and it's very exciting and therefore I'm going to forward the same thing. You can land in very, very in a soup, really, in very, very dangerous territory if you do that. That happens actually to many news organizations itself, because this is the era of fake news, as you know, and I could cite to you many examples of where big channels have committed blunders because of falling for fake news. And therefore now, extremely important, the most important thing that will be your distinguishing factor for anyone is to first bring your credibility to be topmost. Credibility is the ultimate, because unlike in any other organization, for instance, you know, why is today, even today, people will say, Hindu mein maine padha tha toh theek hi hoga, kind of a thing. That kind of a brand value that a Hindu has, because its reporters followed certain kind of ethical guidelines and way of reporting, even if some people may say that they're too boring, they're just, you know, playing it too safe all the time, kind of a thing. But that was very important, so that you keep the credibility factor is very important. So don't give in to that. Give in to only news that is original, the field that you want to specialize in. It could be any field, any part of, if it is sports, if it is glamour, if it is politics, if it is children's issues, human rights, corporate business news, anything. But remember that what you post is what people will remember you by. And ultimately, you may have done 100 good stories and you do one wrong story or put out one wrong tweet, people will go after you for it. While you can earn a big name very well, even without the backing of a very big organization or a brand now, you can build your own individual brands. But it's also a fact that in just one jhatka, that can go away. And therefore, you must use your social media handles and every other posting that you're doing, if you're planning to be a professional journalist, to do it very responsibly and never make that mistake, that temptation. Do not succumb to that temptation, because people will only remember that you did one wrong story and all your good work will be forgotten. And it's like a bullet that's already been fired. If you have fired it, there is no... is it right on the part of a news journalist to include his or her views while reporting news item? Is a question that's being asked. And I... There are two different things. In an editor, in a newspaper, you have an editorial page and you have a news page. So when I am doing a news reporting, I'm not allowed to bring in my views, my biases, in fact, into it, unless it happens unconsciously. For instance, if I'm reporting on a school, for instance, and I somebody I know, or I know the principal, she's my friend, I need to, one, either like judges recuse themselves, similarly, journalists need to say that, say, if my father runs a business in, let's say, electrical company, electrical cars, and if I'm talking about policy for electric vehicles, then I need to say that I have an interest there. I need to declare it. There's a disclaimer that I must put out, and then only I can proceed with it. First of all, your ideal is you won't report on a subject in which you have any kind of a vested interest. Two, you cannot put out your own viewpoints as part of the news. That's a very, very dangerous thing to do. Three, my job as a reporter is to get you all sides of the story, and my job is also not just allowing people to have that platform. I must ask the right questions so that I will say that if you have this viewpoint, isn't this something juxtapose it with? You play the devil's advocate for everyone in case their opposing view is already not there, and make sure that their view is also heard. So that's my job as a journalist, and therefore I'm not allowed to push through my views or my biases in anything that I do. Sometimes, journalism by the choice of the stories you do, by the angle of the story you take, there is a certain bias, or should I say there is a particular angle. For instance, if there is a sexual assault of a child that has happened, your line of questioning will be to protect the child and to be able to take care of all her or his rights, whoever the child may have been, and then proceed further while not showing a bias even towards the person who is accused of that particular crime. In fact, very often all channels, and I've fought with senior police officials earlier, and these days they don't do it any longer. In fact, high court orders are there, Supreme Court orders are there about not showing the faces of the accused. That's not something that's supposed to be done, because only after a court convicts anyone, we are allowed to show their faces, and therefore the trial by the media, which is happening right now, totally wrong, and that is not journalism at all, according to me, because that's what many news channels are doing, because it's also having a big TRP, as many of you would be following. And therefore, so the second part that she says is, with a bulk load of news coming from various sources, how is gatekeeping in place, and how do we ascertain the authenticity of a message? This is a very, very tricky part, because authenticity of the messages, you don't know, because your uncle, who is very well educated, has passed you on something about COVID, some treatment about COVID. You will believe it blindly because it is coming from someone who you think is authentic and who has his best interest in mind as far as you're concerned. But fake news is a very dangerous way of getting into every place. And therefore, I would say, that's why certain handles are, social media handles also, or certain channels are more reliable than others. Mm-hmm. Social media, in fact, you get completely, you can be completely taken for a ride. And I've seen even very educated people fall for it. We also tend to fall for it sometimes. So we have to be doubly careful all the time, asking the question, is this fake? Is this real? Is this fake? Is this real? As you know, in any accident that happens, immediately you'll get so many videos and you don't know which is real and which is not real. Because as I said, the resources are also very limited for news channels. And therefore we are relying sometimes on local people to also give you news. They become your primary source of news, and that without verification can be very dangerous. I remember 2007 when the blast happened here, the twin blasts happened in Hyderabad as well. When people tell you, they will say, you know, they've seen a blast, and they will say, ki, hum khud dekha madam, 40 log to wahan pe aise aise pad gaye the, main khud hi 10-15 logon ko to maine khud hi uthaya. They may be, see, anyone who's a primary responder in a situation and has seen a very dramatic situation will tend to exaggerate. That's one thing. But it may also be true that those people were unconscious and presumed dead by a person who is not medically trained to handle those kind of situations. But unless you have a primary confirmation and you are able to go with that primary confirmation, do not put out the news if you are planning to be, again, as I said, a professional journalist, someone whose news will be, whose news reportage will be valued and respected, and whose views also subsequently will be valued, because they are based on fact and not based on any kind of a bias or prejudice. So be very careful about the kind of posts that you put out in the public media. Doesn't mean that you don't take a stand on issues. That's a different thing altogether. Taking a stand on issues on your personal handle is very different from when you are reporting the same thing, whether it's a CAA. Does your convictions get embedded in your reporting pattern? I would say, it may be unconsciously, it would be, I guess. I mean, sometimes, you know, in some, I have reported a lot on children, women, development issues and so on. And sometimes when I'm introduced at meetings, they say, she's almost an activist. And I used to say, my God, that's a very dangerous thing to say to me, that journalists cannot be activists and we are not meant to be activists. So even though it may appear like that, because of the kind of stories that you may be doing, but that's not a good label for a journalist, because I must not reflect my convictions in that. Yes, I may have a certain bias or a certain, for instance, being a woman, I keep saying that even if it is politics, if it is environment issues, all of them, I will tend to look at it also through a woman angle or also through a child angle. And I think that's an advantage that I have as a woman. And I also get access to those kind of spaces inside homes. I can go into the kitchen, I can go into a bedroom, I can talk to women. Very often women are may or not want to culturally come out and talk to men. So those are advantages that I have that I think is a positive bias that comes in. And I think it actually helps me to tell a more layered story when I'm dealing with reporting even something as tragic as, say, child sexual violence story. The fact that you can go in and talk and create a bond of trust, hopefully. And if you don't violate it, you're not allowed to violate it. There are ethics that we follow in journalism, that if you say you will not do it, you're not allowed to do it. And therefore, that's something that we do follow. I'm going to go to the next one, or should we keep continuing to have questions? Is that... Your views on the ongoing campaign with one popular channel on SSR, is it right or wrong? I'm not going to judge whether it is right or wrong, but it is not journalism. It is entertainment, and I don't watch television much, but sometimes I switch it on for entertainment value just to see, oh my God, how much of a hyperventilating is he going to do, and so on. But even that I can't bear after a while. I mean, at a time when everyone is very depressed with all the time COVID news, there's a fatigue that people have got about COVID and so on and so forth. And therefore, the other story is very exciting. You have glamorous people there, and it is Bollywood, and there's drugs, and there's film. So this combination is a very deadly combination of things that people like to see. It's like a cinema that is unfolding in front of you, except that there are real people. And you are not the judiciary, you are not the police, you are not the investigation. So he has done that even in the past. I mean, in many cases, there was an IPS officer case from Bengaluru that he handled, and he said he was guilty. There is a Shashi Tharoor case. There are many such cases that he has handled. So I don't treat his shows or his channel as reportage. And anyone who sees it would know that it is not reportage. Many people like it. They have high TRP as well. So I have no argument against it. In our country, there's a thing that, you know, people who have, even if I own a political party, I am allowed to still own a channel. And if I had the money, I can make a channel and say, Uma is the most beautiful person, most intelligent, most smart. Nobody can stop me from saying that. It's not illegal to do it. So that is something that everyone is allowed to do. But what is journalism and what is not journalism? On that, we can have a viewpoint that's very different. And I don't consider it as journalism at all. So how is regional news of importance being packaged to fit to the national audiences? Very often what's happening is this national and regional is a very very dangerous kind of categorization that happens. And I believe that a lot of very good journalists actually come from the field. And I'm very grateful that we still have that kind of a network of people who may be passionate about journalism and who are actually getting us the real stories wherever they are happening, however they are happening. And that's a very important, it's not the editors who make newspapers or who make television channels. It is these reporters on the ground who are telling you the daily news, committed people who are telling you what's happening on the ground and looking for those things that are going around, corruption, it may be the administrative bureaucratic kind of a red tape which is happening. All that is very, very important reporting, and it's a failure of the national channels if they are not able to take it up and make them into national channels, national news. Very often the challenge for us is to be able to pick out those beautiful stories and to make it relevant to a national audience. That's what for me as a reporter for a national news channel, so to speak, an English news channel, which of course the audiences is much more limited than the regional news chunks that we are talking about. But to make it relevant to a national news audience is what is my challenge. And I think every story does have a national kind of a echo and relevance. And that's what we try to do when we pick up the stories from, for instance, today was Teachers' Day. And all of you know that teachers is one category which most of the private teachers, actually more than 3 lakh teachers, have lost their jobs. They don't have any salaries. And because they're very, very well-educated, they are not able to go for manual labor or do other kinds of jobs. Then there's a stature that we have in society for a teacher, and therefore they don't even find other jobs. And therefore that's something that we did report on. And you do get your input from everywhere. It could be local channels. These days, most channels are not able to do justice to journalism the way they should have been doing. How do you adjust the management's bias? Actually, I've not had any management interacting with me on anything. I have spent 30 years, the first 10 years in the Times of India, and then 20 years in NDTV. I've never been told to report a particular story as news or not report a particular story. When we do these days, when we do some features we do for raising money, those are called sponsored features, and we write them as sponsored features, and we usually don't have our editorial staff in fact working on those stories. We are supposed to have a separate staff working on those stories. Sangeeta, I missed your chat, I think, your question, I think. I have to go back and see that question. the convergence of television and other technologies opened up a lot of opportunities for marketers to target customers. The other thing is that for all youngsters, I'm saying, having access to technology, you have your phones, please come up with new models of media that will not just be sustainable, but also will catch the imagination of larger audiences. People like us, many a time some news is flashed and then news never comes back, and even that information is not closed. As public, you are left in the lurch like that. Okay, that is not supposed to happen. You are supposed to, you, if you get breaking news, it's not so important to put out the breaking news, as important as confirming it and taking it forward. That is not good journalism at all if people leave it like that. In fact, very often when we report on stories as well, we my tradition, should I say, some people have followed over 20 years to tell their story to people. One widow is there, some child is there, somebody who we have reported on and people have shown a lot of interest or have helped. We have tried to do their follow-up. So they become part of your extended family very often. And that way, I have almost many people, in fact, who are part of that family. One of those things is, I'll miss the next question as well. If you were to put it back, I can perhaps, because I'm missing out on the chats. And I'm running very long, Anindita.
No, it's okay. We have two more questions, but we cannot move away from this. We want to hear you on this. I'm just apologizing from the other speakers. Maybe we'll just overshooting our time, but please bear. It's very interesting discussion. Thank you so much.
Am I audible still? Uma Sundari is speaking.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Can you bring that? I don't know why I'm not able to go back to chat to see what the question was.
I'll read it out to you. Good evening, ma'am. Yeah. From Vinith George. Good evening, ma'am. Many television debates begin with a foregone conclusions of the news anchor. Shouldn't the television debates ideally leave the task of arriving at conclusions to the audience? More or less, you have answered, but once again.
Absolutely. I mean, one of the things that we say is that in television debates, sometimes there's this thing, isn't it? Yes or no. Say yes or say no. And then you have these things where you have these voting that happens, and concluding what your line of argument is going to be and then selecting the guests according to that, that's not good journalism. You are supposed to allow people with a very different viewpoint to come there and say what they say. Doesn't mean that, it's not like the Prime Minister's interviews where you give him a platform and you ask about the opposition and he can just hold forth on that and go on and on. That's also not journalism. What you do is you allow people with who you may agree or not agree, but put forth the questions that come as doubts to you, that challenge that kind of a viewpoint, such that the audience is able to hear everyone's viewpoint and get the counter to that as well. And therefore, I make my conclusion. Don't presume that your audience is somebody who's not intelligent. The audience is very intelligent and they can make out from not just the body language. They have their own reasons why they have a particular viewpoint, and therefore allow them. The idea of a debate is to allow multiple viewpoints to come through and not to push through your own viewpoint. And therefore, that's why I'm saying that is not a very good format in which many news programs are. In fact, very often, there are certain news channels that tell you that, we have a morning meeting, 9 o'clock meeting, then we have a 12 o'clock meeting and so on. And they make this news list. And the angle of the story is also told in some channels, I'm told. I do understand. But so I keep telling them that you cannot decide the angle of the story in Delhi, because the reporter has to go out and explore for himself or herself what the angle is. And only then you will know what the angle of the story is. So don't pre-conclude already that yehi hone wala hai, hum isliye yehi wala isi ke saath jaane wale hai, whatever the conclusion. And therefore, then the bites and the story is woven around to whatever the agenda that the anchor and the editor already has in mind. And that's, I think, terrible journalism. You will never find out anything new. That's why the quality of journalism has been very poor in our country, because one, it is only guided by what certain editors are thinking and what they think the story should be from any part of the country. Sorry. So two, three
and
things
that
I want to
tell. We have another question that is sent to us. I'll just read out the question to you, ma'am.
Yeah.
How do they cope up with issues when they cover the issues for some time, which is very important or sensational, but the moment another issue arises, they leave the earlier one?
Okay. This happens very often in television, especially. Actually, it happens in all media. It's a herd mentality. So everyone, all the sheep go in one direction. Somebody else points it in something else, and everyone else goes in that direction. So you will have, even a Sushant Singh Rajput issue, I'm saying. Some channel covered it, and even though everyone else criticized it, and yet everyone went to it and covered it, that's really not the good example for me to give, not the ideal example for me to give. In that case, there were reasons. Many people don't agree with why the other channels also did those interviews. I do believe it was important for that girl to have another platform to be able to tell her viewpoint when she was being vilified on elsewhere. What is more important than that is, yes, the cycle of news is such that you will move on from one news story to the other, and that is something that you cannot stop. Like when we ask some bureaucrats for information, they'll say, day after tomorrow. I say, it cannot wait for day after tomorrow, because I actually need it within the next half an hour, because I'm going with a bulletin at 2 o'clock. For instance, I've called at 1 o'clock and say, I need it urgently, and therefore you need to bring me the news now. You need to tell me whatever information you have, please share it now. Only then I can put it out, because it cannot wait for day after, because by the time the story is forgotten and nobody is interested in it. So one is the nature of news itself, that it is going to change, and therefore people will move on. I mean, if before COVID came, we were all CAA, NRC, CAA, NRC. Have you heard anything CAA, NRC in the last few months? It's forgotten. It's something that's completely forgotten. There was a time when it was only the University of Hyderabad, thing that was happening there at that time. All those things were completely taken with. So that's the nature of the beast, as we call it. So that's something that you cannot help. But to keep it meaningful is the responsibility of journalists, and to keep it relevant to what people are experiencing and feeling in their daily lives, that's also the responsibility of the journalists and the channels. And I would also say, to some extent, the responsibility of the audiences as well, because everyone says bad journalism. Sushant Singh Rajput ko headline bana diya, lekin wohi sab sunna chahte hain, wohi sab dalenge sham ko jaake, acha kya hua, uske bhai ko arrest kar liya. We want to know what happened, why that happened, and so on and so forth. While we criticize it, we want to see it also, we want to know it, because somewhere there's a vicarious, I guess, aspect to it. And also, when you're discussing with your friends, you need to know what's happened. I'm usually very down on all that, and then I have to get an update from my daughter what happened today on that, so that I also know what is the development of the day on those kind of issues. But I'm saying it's dangerous that we keep moving on like that, and we don't do anything to its logical conclusion. But it's also a fact that in India you have so many issues that every day there's something which is agitating us, something big that happened. And every time railway accident happens, we say, oh, then last time we remembered it, only it was so many years ago when the accident happened, and so on. So, but we have too much happening all the time, and that's one reason I think we keep jumping from one to the other without really necessarily doing justice to the topic.
I guess we have another question.
Yes, sir. It's cracking people's mind, and it's become an abuse term, Mr. Sundaram. Breaking news. I mean, people are laughing at journalists because of that, and that's, I think, it's sad for not just us as journalists, but the institution of the media itself has become a circus. And therefore, in the public eye, people would earlier respect you and say, oh my God, you belong to the media, and therefore you can do this, and you'll do something meaningful, and therefore we'll come to you. Now, if people are going to look at you as people who are sold to a certain ideology, or sold to certain thoughts, or sold to certain corporate houses, who is going to respect you? And if the institution goes down, it's something that very valuable that the country is losing, and we as a democracy are losing. It's a very valuable institution, and therefore I think we need to remember that as young journalists, that even if you are individuals, because you people are smart with technology, you may be able to come up with new models, media models that are sustainable, and yet maintain all the ethics that are required, values. And one of the things that I would always tell people, it's not brilliance that really counts. It's not brilliance that counts, but consistency counts. Consistently telling the truth, consistently being sincere to what you're doing, and trying to do the best job that you do. And I can tell you, you will come on top of whatever you're doing. That consistency is something that you must remember. People are afraid to ask questions because they feel their knowledge gaps may be exposed. get those knowledge gaps, they will be actually very small, where you realize that when you don't know technology, you think, oh my God, this is so daunting. You know, you think about it like that. When you start using it, you realize it's the simplest thing possible. You know, what all the youngsters are doing it like that, and we are struggling with technology, we think, but it's actually very simple. So try to make that little effort to get over the knowledge gap. And then the second thing is learn to ask questions, learn to ask meaningful questions. Speak out is something that that you must take courage to do that. And you're allowed to do that, not just as a journalist, but as a woman, as a youngster, wherever you feel that you are wrong. Doesn't mean that you go around fighting. I'm saying learn the art of negotiation with people without showing anger, and while making your point at the same time, staying calm and yet making your point, I think, is very important. We argue that in our editorial meetings. We argue that with people with who you may completely disagree with their viewpoint, and yet you must listen to them and try to see what is what you can take away from there.
I guess, ma'am, there's one last interesting question that we take from the chat. While exposing big things or big records, the journalists have life threats. How do you handle that?
Life threats. Is that what the question is? Something else I saw here,
yes.
About something else, masala.
Yes,
okay.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Life threats is actually quite real. While many journalists in regional areas have very little protection because they don't even have a social profile. For a Ravish Kumar, for instance, if he has life threats, or Gauri Lankesh, we are all talking about it, anniversary of her, the day that she was shot dead as well. Life threats is something, it's not a sudden thing that's happening. It's part of the same process of not allowing voices to come out and not allowing truth to come out. And that's an effort. I'm not saying all politicians are criminals, all political parties are trying to do that, but in their own ways, whether it's the ruling party at the center, ruling party in Telangana, ruling party in Andhra Pradesh, everywhere the pattern is the same, absolutely the same. They would not want you to put out stuff that is inimical to them. That is understandable as well. And they also are also achieving that very well by controlling many media channels and therefore the content in the media channels as well. So that is not something that we can fight. Like I said, anyone can own a channel. Therefore, political parties also can own channels. The only thing that I would say is audiences need to be discerning about where they're getting whatever the kind of news that they're getting. I'm forgetting the line of argument. We were going to talk about threats. Threats is something that you will get in a in two, three manner. One is a physical threat itself. When we go, I'll just share one example. For instance, when we were doing some expose in Ballari, where we had those famous brothers from Ballari. And I was told when we were going there that if you go there and akkada, people will bury you also. Nobody will even know where you are buried. So nobody will know any kind of evidence will not come out about where you are and what you are. So you must be very careful, they said. But you went there, you did your reporting, you came back. Of course, I belong to NDTV and therefore I will be doing live from somewhere, so on and so forth. You may think of it as something that gives you a certain degree of protection in that sense. That's why, but in many places it doesn't. One is if you go to political parties, you get attacked. You can get physically attacked as well. I was attacked by Jalalita's party when I reported that she's gone to jail, not something of my doing, her own doing, and the court's doing, but the court had decided on that. But till that time, they were feeding us all laddus and all that, thinking she's coming out. And the minute we knew that the thing was coming out, and then we reported that it is coming out, and then suddenly decided that they decided that I was speaking in Hindi and reporting for a Hindi channel. This is anti-Hindi people from North India, and therefore let's attack her. The reason they attacked her was not me. The reason they attacked her was because they thought Jayalalitha ma'am watches English channels and she likes NDTV, she will watch NDTV. So if we show her angst that she's been arrested on NDTV by attacking the journalist, then it'll air on NDTV and therefore madam will see. And therefore there are always those kind of reasons why people will attack you. I have been following these child trafficking rackets for a long time. In 2000 as well, babies being sold. Even today actually we had a baby who was buried alive from East Godavari. Horrible visuals. So the baby was alive ultimately when they took him out. It was a baby boy, incidentally. But I'm just going to relate one incident of this child trafficking. So 20 years ago, this happened. Then the government said government agencies cannot, the private agencies cannot give anyone for adoption. Only the government's own Shishu Viharas, they were called, only they will be giving the children for adoption. So many years later, we went again to those kind of areas and looked for baby with somebody else. I went as a couple and we were supposed to go and buy a baby. And we were taken into a Shishu Vihar and we were shown babies and we were told, ye wala baby chahiye, wo wala baby chahiye, aap koi bhi le jao, no problem. I said, aapka to register hota hoga, kya karenge fir? Nahi, wo sab book adjustment ho jata madam, magar aaj aap Babita ek baby ko le gaye, to dusra baby aa jayega, usko Babita naam de denge, koi problem nahi hai, so there will be no difference in the baby. So with the technology, what happened was, now I said, no, I can't take it now. I have to see a good muhurtam before I take baby home. So because it's illegal also for me to bring a baby back home. Then he said, nene, aap kal aate to 3 kg ka gaya, 2-3 kg ke gaye. What is 3 kg? 3 kg is baby. Saying yesterday, aap kal sham ko aate to 3 kg ka aapko milta, aap miss kar gaye. Kal sham ka aapka miss ho gaya. Then within a week, he sends me for photographs of babies who I can select on WhatsApp. The technology had changed now. You don't need to physically go there. He said, agar aapko Hyderabad mein hi male baby chahiye, to aap ek hafta do, main aapko Hyderabad mein laake dunga. Then we went there to pick up a baby for who there was a price that was negotiated in 30,000 rupees something. And the gentleman who I went with is an activist who unfortunately actually died of COVID recently. And he was very over enthusiastic. And after the baby, all that negotiation happened and they showed us the baby and all that. He said, ki meeru adanta ichar kada memo golden unguram istamu kinds. So over generous he was. And therefore she got very suspicious. She was a Don, Lady Don there. And she has many murder cases on her and so on and so forth. So then she held us captive inside a house. And she beat up other people in front of her place. And we had no cell phones, nothing on us because we were going on a decoy identity. So we got out of those kind of situations where you're physically beaten also for whatever we were lucky. Therefore, we got out is all that I'm saying. So physical threats happen everywhere, whether you go on just a hospital that is sex testing kind of a thing. We were beaten up in such a place also in one of the districts in Hyderabad where the hospital didn't directly attack us. The group in the villages came and they said, idi chala manchi doctor andi adi ani, because obviously they were all paid people. So they attacked us there and then they attacked us and then you come back because obviously the doctor had paid them off. Subsequently, that man also got arrested. This lady who I'm saying, who is the Don who has cases, she also got arrested. She's out on bail also subsequently. I'm saying so physical threats can happen and then you are attacked on social media and that's something even more dangerous, I think, because it's invisible and it tries to attack your character and your standing in a particular place and therefore trying to destroy your credibility. They will say, she has got money from Chandrababu Naidu. She has got house from Jagan Mohan Reddy. And KCR, I think, villa katla reach lo untarandi, itla phone teesi villa matladte asalu matladistaru. I mean, all those rumors will be there and they will attribute things to you and it will be as though it's the most genuine thing that has happened. And those attempts, I think, are very, very dangerous. I have personally experienced those kind of attacks in many, very devious manners in which they will attack you as, I mean, they think of you as one powerful couple that they made you out to be. But whereas I can tell you that I have absolutely no power at all, unlike what people presume that you can just call up somebody and get something done and so on and so forth. I don't do that and I don't have the power to do it either. But people presume. And more important than presumption is the fact that there is a malicious campaign that can happen in order to try and destroy your credibility.
Oh, thank you, ma'am. I guess more or less we've answered all the questions that came in also in the chat. And
two more questions are there. Maybe Uma, if you can just answer on chat. One is, what is the future of print media, especially after this COVID time? And also one more question is that how you cope up with, I think this is more or less answered, that how you cope up with an issue which you cover very passionately and you see nothing comes out of it. So these two are, I think, the questions for you. Suppose you're covering something very passionately and you really don't get to see the end result, which you're really looking at from a very ethical or, right, correct, quote unquote, correct point of view. How, as a journalist, you deal with and future of print media. So these two, if you can answer on chat. I'm sorry, Uma, to stop you like this, but then.
No. I'm glad, and I apologize to the other speakers as well. We are keeping them all there. Two things. You're all going to be future journalists, so I don't want to be painting a very bleak picture for you, but future of print and television, more importantly, even more important than print, is very bleak, is something that I must admit to you. And that's one reason why I am saying, start building your own media profile, your own work that will stand by itself, and you will realize, did Amitabh Bachchan or any of them think that at some point they will not require any other agency at all? They didn't need, none of them requires anything. They are all using their own social media handles. You don't need a PR network for them to get in touch with anyone. Now we are seeing new models of journalism coming up, which can be aggregators or new, everything is, technology allows many, many things. Now, see, everyone now does live chats like we are doing, like Zoom chats and so on and so forth. So quality will be your differentiator, and what you will choose to tell, and in an interesting manner, because now it's a crowd in the media space, huge crowd, and technology has made it accessible to everyone. It's not just now a Bennett Coleman and Company or an EDTV or a India Today group which is controlling everything. You also have the power to do it. And you build it very small, built from those scratch. I mean, you may get a very small subscription initially. Don't get disheartened by it. If you believe in your product and go forward. I met the couple, who actually had graduated from ISB, but they do that, the Better India, I think. Yeah, they do those positive stories on India and so on and so forth. So find your niche. It could be a business. It could be anything, but go with it, because I do believe that print media, television media, the way we know it, cannot sustain. Not just COVID, even otherwise it was on its deathbed. COVID is really, I don't like to say it, I belong to this medium, but the final nail on the coffin in many senses. Because even if, I'm a vegetarian, but there is something called halal and there's something called jhatka. So, now we are bleeding out slowly, and the quality is going out of all the journalism, and therefore people will start not giving you, you're no longer the premier product that you may be, because you're not able to invest resources in it. You have the human resource, you have the ability to use your resources in a manner that's meaningful to people and relevant to people still. All that is very important, and therefore I think print media, television media, as we are seeing it, or as we saw it in the last decade, is not going to exist very longer. And that's why I said those convergence newsrooms is what we are looking at. Already you saw many, already we were talking about one newspaper dying every day in other parts of the world. Whereas India was the only country where, in fact, we were seeing a boom. I mean, one of the very few countries where we were seeing a boom in the print media, and still it was going up. But with the kind of cost that we are seeing and with the kind of situations in which we are economically, I don't see this going very far. And
true, ma'am.
If it's going to be lost without any, with its value gone, then the product itself is not worth it. Because credibility and quality, if they both are gone, then nothing else is left.
Absolutely, ma'am. We agree with you on that. I guess there was a lot of learning from what you said, not just for the budding journalists, but also for the other practitioners as well. We had so much to learn. Thank you so much, ma'am, for the wonderful insights. Pleasure. And I guess as an underlining point to what ma'am said, I think we all have to conclude that more than anything, it is us. We have to, because now media is all, it's in our hands, like ma'am said. I think it is in our hands how we sell ourselves, how we sell our credibility, and how credibly we put forward our food to make it, or to make our mark in the media. Thank you very much, ma'am.
My pleasure. Thank you so much.
Yes.
Thank you so much, Uma. Thank you so much for your time. I think one full day can go with you, with your experience and case studies. Brilliant, brilliant. Thank you so much, Uma, for accepting the invite and for so long. Thank you so much.
Now we'll move on to our next speaker for the day, Mahua, ma'am. She is already here. I'm sorry, ma'am, for keeping you waiting, but So I now ask Anandita ma'am to introduce our second speaker for the day, Ms. Mahua Gore.
Again, as I said, that the profile is there. We have circulated everyone, so I will not read out. Again, a beautiful transformational coach and a business coach. And the way, you know, we both went on a workshop and we were participants, but she was, you know, almost overpowering the faculty. I'm sorry to say that. And it's brilliant. I mean, the way she maps people. In fact, one day I just called K. Mahua, just talk to my son. He's just not listening to me. Just see how you can orient him. I mean, she's brilliant and a very, very close friend. Mahua, without wasting any more time, please teach us something.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Anandita. Very good evening to everybody. And congratulations to YCC for organizing this. Thank you, Fronia. And Uma ji, so much of knowledge from you. I think it's very exciting and a very interesting topic. Like Anandita said, so much to learn. With that, I would like to wish everybody a very happy Teacher's Day. Pata hi nahi chala, student se kabhi teacher ban gaye. So that's what I was feeling. And request Pranya, if you can run the PPT, I will be running through it actually. I'll complete in some 8 to 10 minutes, after which we will open up for questions and answers. But before that, I have a small request. So I see more than 15 to 20 students whose videos are off. So I have this one habit of drawing energies from the smiling faces of people, right? So if I can have a couple of you keeping your videos on and just, you know, look at the screen, that is going to make me much faster and much more effective.
Absolutely. So with that, absolutely. Fully agree with you.
Thank you, Anandita. So with that, the topic today I have chosen definitely is communicate to win. So this winning is pretty important that I figured out. And about journalism, about the communication within your domain, I think, you know, the masters are there already and you've all learned from the master herself, Uma herself. But then I will be talking to you about the other aspects of communication in your life. Okay, and how do we communicate to win? Okay, so with this, let's move on. So what happens when, you know, change happens? Fronia, you have to help me with the slides, please.
Yes.
So what happens when the normal resets? I really want a couple of participants to put up on the chat box. What do you feel whenever there's a change? Today in the pandemic, with the lockdown, there are so many changes that are happening. Our work is changing, our way of working, things are definitely, you know, there's a lot of turmoil. So whenever normal resets, what happens in the psyche of people? Maybe you can put up your answers here, but yes, we have seen fear. Fear, whether will I be able to keep up the job? Will my salary match with what I'm actually worth? Different levels of fear. And finally, yes, uncertainty and panic triggers on. See, all different age groups have different panics. Hamare age group mein we think of different things, but the students and learners and newcomers, you know, the freshers, you guys will have a very different kind of a panic. But yes, we do, hit the panic button. Yes, good. I have a couple of answers here, but I wanted to take you through a story. Of course, you know, all of you are storytellers, but let me just remind you of a story which I heard when I was very small. So once there is a small girl who comes home and she's crying. Then the mother asks her, what happened to you? Why are you crying so much? And the small girl says, see, my life is at the end. You know, kuch nahi ho sakta hai mera. I've completely reached the end at such a small age. What happened? No, the principal hates me. My school class teacher have removed my monitorship. Mera best friend mere ko chhod diya. So all these negative things are happening. No matter how much the mother says that, no, all will work out well. Finally, things will be fine. Maybe this is an opportunity for you to focus on studies. But we all know what happens when parents give gyan at this kind of situations. So obviously the girl was not taking it very well. But then finally the mother takes the daughter to the kitchen and starts baking a cake. Now, while mixing the ingredients, the mother says, would you want to taste it? Then the girl says, no, it's not going to be tasty. I don't want it. Then when in the oven, half baked, the mother again asks the daughter, do you want to taste it now? She says, no, chi mom, what's up to you? I don't want to eat it now. I'll eat the final product. So finally, when she enjoys the cake, that's when the mother says, look, if you had the faith till end, And that is why the final product is good, but the ingredients and the procedure was not good. So that is what happens when the situations change. Whenever there is a large change like what we are going through today, we will feel squeezed, we will feel negative, we are going to feel desperate because there is loss from all angles, right? There is loss everywhere. But we need to understand that when the change is happening, finally the cake will be baked because the master baker has a plan. The master baker has a recipe, isn't it? So what happens is, next one, what happens really, Fronia, the next one, is that a new normal emerges. Yes, a new normal is going to emerge at the end of all this turmoil of pandemic that we are going through. But when the new normal emerges, my suggestion to all the youngsters sitting here is that you may be the category of people who are waiting for new opportunities to come your way. You may be a group of people who are going to go out and seek the new opportunities. You know, talking to people, trying out new ways and seeking the new opportunities. But I am very, very sure by looking at the profile of people here, the mentors who are here, most of you are those guys who are going to create new opportunities for you. Like Ms. Uma said earlier, maybe you will create some new kind of news reporting or some new kind of... Now, in the chat box, I want the students particularly to write down that what new out-of-the-box careers can you think of? You know, for example, like we said, Netflix. Netflix emerged when there was something very bad happening to the movies, CDs on rent, right? So similarly, at this point of time, what do you think because of the pandemic, because of the new normal which is emerging, what new opportunities, out of the box opportunities can you think about? So put up on the chat box, let me give you three very important issues about creating new opportunity. What do you need? You need to think outside the box, creative thinking. You have to be proactive. See, this is not the time where we keep on waiting ki kahin se kuch mil jaye. कोई कुछ आइडिया दे दे, कोई कुछ नया बना ले, आई विल गो एंड लॉग इन. दैट इज नॉट गोइंग टू हैपन. सो प्रोएक्टिविटी इज इंपॉर्टेंट. थर्डली इज नेगोशिएटिंग. सी ऑल वॉक्स ऑफ आवर लाइव्स, वी आर ऑल द टाइम नेगोशिएटिंग, इजंट इट? वी आर नेगोशिएटिंग. फॉर नेगोशिएटिंग वी नीड अ वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट पॉइंट, दैट इज फ्रोनिया. नेक्स्ट पॉइंट प्लीज. No, communicating effectively. So we will talk about three dimensions of communication. So these three dimensions of communication is very close to my heart. Today, I want to talk to you about. The first dimension is internal communication. See, what we talk to others, what people are talking to us, more than that, most important point, dimension is what you are talking to yourself. Aap apne aap se kya baat kar rahe ho? Kaun se level pe baat kar rahe ho? Are you all the time talking negative to yourself? Are you cutting yourself short? Are you fanning doubts within your mind? So that is the internal communication. Second part is external communication. Now this, by this I mean, see, till January or February, all of us, including me, we were spending 90% of our time outside. Office mein, college mein, outside. We were just talking to people in our work sphere. But suddenly today we have to talk to our support system, our family members, friends. So though it is external communication, it's very much your internal team. So external communication is your communication with your family and support system. Third one is external communication. Quickly we'll go through all the three dimensions. Yeah, so internal communication, what is important? Definitely do not become the biggest enemy of yourself. I see a lot of young women here. I am somebody who's very much against gender bias, but I have seen, unfortunately, I have seen that most of the internal dialogues that women have, young girls have, I'm also guilty of this. Most of our internal dialogues are flawed. Hum log kya sochte hai? I'm a girl, so I must work harder than others so that I can come up. Being a woman, if I want a successful career, I must work harder than the men because I have to balance and work and life. This is our internal communication going on. If this is our internal communication, it is draining out 50% of our creativity. So my suggestion here is that let your internal communication be reassuring. I messed up, I can fix it. So you have to reassure yourself, right? So I messed up, but I will fix it. At the same time, it must be challenging. Only then you can push yourself out of the comfort zone. And of course, loving, self-love. Everybody today is talking about self-love. But at my level or at your level, as a student, when I talk about self-love, I don't think 9 out of 10 people understand. I have seen most of my clients feeling deep-rooted that I do not deserve to be loved. I lack something. Mujhme zarur koi kami hai. This is what is internal dialogue goes on, but we need to come out of that. Now let's talk about what are the important issues you have to handle when you are talking to your family and support system. Ex-internal communication. This is the time not to be aggressive nor to be submissive. This is the time you have to talk to your family and communicate assertively. Like I said, now you are interacting more with your family. You don't want to be traded on. At the same time, you don't want to be coming across very aggressive. Assertive, positive. Why? Because believe it or not, I have to say that everybody is only listening negative, right? Kya mera job rahega? Kya mera income kam ho jayega? I am losing money. Mere bank se EMIs cut ho ja rahe. Everything everybody is thinking is only negative. So if you are somebody who can talk positive within your family, I think that you got it, right? And third important thing is this communication must come from heart to heart with your support system. We will ponder upon this heart to heart communication a bit more in the next slides. So external communication, I will give you one, Pranaya, yeah, this slide please. Now, I will give you only one line. See, today in the new normal, post lockdown, when you're going back for, you know, creating that mark as a career woman or career person, the objective is going to be, can you bring in, are you somebody who can bring a win-win situation on the table or not? Are you somebody who can sort of, you know, maneuver your way? Can you bring in a solution which is win-win for all? Because everybody is losing now. So how do you do that? How can you actually bring in win-win communication? First point is that communicate from your heart and not your mind. I'm not talking about journalism, my dear friends. I'm not saying you communicate from your heart in the, you know, while you're reporting. I'm not talking that. I'm talking about negotiation skills. I'm talking about creating opportunities. How do you do that? As you, most of you must be knowing, this is a recap that human brain, we have 3 kinds of brains, right? So we don't have only one brain. Actually, it's not possible to think from your heart. हार्ट का काम थिंकिंग नहीं होता है, हार्ट का काम खाली पंपिंग ब्लड ही होता है. बट व्हाट वी मीन इज दैट वी हैव 3 टाइप्स ऑफ ब्रेन, पार्ट्स ऑफ द ब्रेन. वन इज द लॉजिकल ब्लू कलर नियोकॉर्टेक्स, दिस इज द रैशनल ब्रेन. देन यू हैव लिम्बिक ब्रेन, इमोशनल और द फीलिंग ब्रेन, राइट? एंड एवरी टाइम दैट यू कम्युनिकेट फ्रॉम द लिम्बिक ब्रेन, कीपिंग इमोशंस इन माइंड, यू विल सी दैट यू आर मोस्ट इफेक्टिव एट दैट पर्टिकुलर पॉइंट ऑफ टाइम. And the third brain is, of course, the reptilian brain, that is for reflexes and, you know, sudden emotions and sudden feelings. But limbic brain is your key. Emotional communication is your key for a win-win conversation, for a passionate conversation. So what are the different benefits of having a passionate conversation? I will let you know just 1 or 2 things. First of all, a passionate conversation which is from the limbic brain is always more convincing. For example, let me ask all the, you know, girls and guys in teens, 20s here, saying that if your mother comes and says, I want to clean the room now, right? Versus, can you please try to clean your room today? I'm really feeling tired and it will bring down my burden. Which approach would you love? Isn't it always the second approach? Because, you know, this is coming from emotions. The mother is conveying the emotion and that is why it is more convincing. Secondly, this builds relationship. My dear friends, in the 5 years to come, if you want to be successful, you need relationships now more than ever. So your passionate conversation or the emotion conversation is going to build relationship, reduce resistance. Okay, it immediately is accepted. Whatever you are talking now is accepted immediately. And that is why it reduces resistance and creates a win-win situation. Yeah. So actually about this, I can help you out, because what you can do is I have a website called mahuagorthi.com. In case, you know, you need any communication tips, or sometimes we get stuck with certain patterns in our behavior, you know, we get stuck with certain communication flaws. So So if you can drop a query there, we'll get back to you. I've recently written a book called Discover Your Mystic Edge. This is about internal communication. This is how you can bring the best out of you at turbulent times. So with this, you know, I would like to, of course, this is my email ID. With this, I would like to leave you and open the floor for question answers. But before that, Frania, the last slide, please. Before that, like I started with a story, I would like to end this session with a story again. So what is the story? Again, could be a recap for few of you, but anyways, you know, it's fun. There's a pregnant deer. Now this pregnant deer is about to give birth and it's just walking around the river when it suddenly sees, she sees a hungry lion. And now she's very worried because, you know, any moment uska pain aane wala, it's in labor pain and the hungry lion is around. So it turns around and it says that, okay, let me now run away. And when it turns around, it sees a hunter. Now it can neither go towards left or right because it's trapped. Now it wants to run towards the forest back, though he can't run, kyunki uska halat aisa nahi hai ki it can run. So now suddenly there's a forest fire. So this is a catch 22 situation, as we call, because the deer is thinking, ho gayi meri, lag gayi baat. Neither I can go this side, that side, or go back to fire the forest because I'm trapped. Now what happens? What really happens at that point of time is that, you know, there's a story, but then yeah, in the story, you can notice there's a cloudy sky. So suddenly there's a lightning. And because of the lightning, the hunter misses the arrow. The is startled and the arrow goes and hits the hungry lion. The lion dies, but before dying, it attacks the hunter and kills the hunter. And now it starts raining, lightning ke baad raining. So with the rain, the forest fire is also, you know, taken care of, is extinguished. And the deer gives birth to a beautiful young baby deer. So what is the moral of the story is that sometimes we feel that we are in a catch 22, difficult, toughest situation. But what we don't know is that there is some element which is going to come, you know, which is going to change this entire scenario and make things fall in place. So we need to have trust on the new normal. We need to wait for the new normal. And not only wait, we need to capture that, you know, effectively. We need to capture those opportunities effectively. Communication can be your biggest ally if you wish to. So with that, thank you very much for the opportunity. And yeah, over to you, back to you, Anindita. Thank you.
Ma'am, could you please unmute your...
No, I said back to our moderator, Fronia.
Yes, yes.
Yeah, thank you so much, Mahua, ma'am. That was lovely. After a brainstorming session from Uma, ma'am, I guess this was something that, you know, everybody needs to hear in this in these testing times of be it COVID or be it the pressure due to everyone being in the lockdown. I think we had a good deal of how to communicate with ourselves, how to manage ourselves in this situation of troubling times. So now I open, without wasting any much time, I open the quote for questions from the audience. You can ask questions in the chat box, or you can please unmute yourself, your videos, and please ask questions, whoever wants to ask questions to Mahua ma'am.
We already have one, Mahua. I'll quickly read out. Sonia, you can do the same. Please give some tips to deal with mood swings, especially in this challenging lockdown times.
Yes. So Anindita, I saw that while I'm not a, you know, the absolute authority in the area of psychology, but what works as a coach, I'll tell you what works is mood swings. The more you resist, the worse it gets. Okay. So if today I woke up feeling sad and I don't want to fight that, right? I want to feel sad. If I need to shout at people, I need to shout at people. Because when you have an outlet, right, that is the time you can again get back. That is pretty human. But at the same time, I saw Sangeeta asking this question. It is important that your people around you, right, your family and friends or associates know what you are doing. You know, they should not, it should not look like you are lashing out. Okay, so that has been a good way of dealing with mood swings, negativity, depression. For me, it has worked. For a lot of my students also, it has worked. Vent out, communicate, again, get back that way.
One more question.
I have a question.
We came to came is who is more difficult to deal with, a child or an adult?
Believe me, when I see look at children of 4 years or 5 years also, they today are behave like a small adult. you know, it's all in our eyes. So here again, there is a story. One lady, you know, is in a supermarket billing counter, and this lady has a 3-year-old child with her. So this baby girl, you know, she is throwing things, tantrums and shouting and all that. And the girl, the mother, she is saying, Mary, be cool, be calm. This is not the way to react. Please be calm. So somebody observer goes and says, don't you think the child is too small? 3 saal ki bachchi hai yaar, itne bade bade baatein bol rahe ho. So the mother says, no, it's Mary is my name. Okay, so she is actually telling to herself that calm down and keep your calm, because it's all the time when you're looking at your lens matters. If you're looking at a child and considering her or him as an adult, he or she will behave like an adult.
So yes, we had another question from the audience.
I have a question. Can I ask my question?
Please. Yes, sir.
Yeah.
Yes.
So that was a lovely way you explained relationships.
Thank you.
So what I want to tell you is that I believe that the strongest line, connecting two people, fostering relationships, are the lines of laughter, yes, are the lines of humor. Absolutely. What do you have to say on that?
Absolutely, Ramanderji, that's so true. You know, we connect on an emotional level, and when two people are laughing together, you are going to stay together. My only concern would be that this should become natural. You know, this should come naturally. It should not so happen that, yeah, it should not be imposed that, you know, I'm purposely, because all of us are not jests, you know, we are not jokers. So we can't keep cracking jokes. If I am able to share something, if I'm able to share a quirk about myself, which is making you laugh, that is your best bonding. And you are right on that. Absolutely.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Next question, Sonia.
Yes, ma'am. So here's a question. How to keep ourselves away from nagging people is one question that came in the chat box.
Yeah. See, there are no realities in the world. We believe that there are no realities. It's all perception. We may find two types of people nagging. Okay. The first kind of people who are completely opposite to our behavior. For example, if I'm somebody very cheerful and positive, then if somebody is coming with a negative, a little questioning mindset, I feel he or she is nagging. If I'm somebody who's a go-getter, you know, very dominating, and if somebody is always telling me about relationship, I will feel that person is nagging. So either the person is completely opposite of you, that is why you feel that person is nagging, or you have a memory in your, you know, childhood where there was a relative or some kind of elderly figure who reminds, this person reminds you of that elderly figure. So you have associated this behavior with nagging. But my suggestion is, dig deep into that nag. Is there a real point? You know, if, you know, Fronia is going on telling me, madam, please be on time. Humko bahut time ho jayega. Aap 15 minute se zyada nahi lena. I may look at it as Fronia is nagging me, or I may look at it as, arey, she has a point. Correct. There are so many other people. So, you know, it is all the perception. My always suggestion is, don't take the nag, take the point. Thank you. Yeah. So with that,
okay. Ma'am, I have another question.
Yeah, please.
Because in the lockdown, businesses are at a standstill. There are a lot of offices shutting down and all that. You know, how do you, I guess on a personal note, we are all handling ourselves very beautifully, I must say. There's a lot from all sides. So how do we handle this situation where we are also keeping ourselves and calm, and we also need this answerability to our own people, that is a family who is around us?
Yeah, so most of what you are asking, Pranya, now I thought that we've already covered it in the positivity and, you know, managing moods and self. What is the missing link? Like, I'm not getting the question very clearly.
Now the people are locked down, confined to homes, both work from home has led to a lot of confrontation, domestic violence and divorce. Okay, I mean, as you spoke about win-win communication, what are your tips?
Basically, it's so true. Exactly, yeah. You know, that's what Anandita, what I was saying, that earlier a husband and wife were meeting only on Saturday nights. and Sunday and they could bear each other. But now you have to, you know, every day, 24 hours, you are with that person. So definitely confrontations are increasing. Now, that is why I said, see, confrontation kab hota hai? Ya to aap bahut der se suppress karke rakh rahe ho. You are suppressing your emotions or feelings. You're not telling. I'll give you a small example. Maybe the, wife is doing all the housework continuously and suppressing herself, thinking that ye mera kaam hai, yehi mera job hai. And she's just suppressing. One fine day, she will just, you know, blast out. My suggestion is that bottling up doesn't help. That is what I said, that you vent out and move on. But if you talk about domestic violence, etc., that is a very deep subject. I think that that is not in the is daire mein nahi padta hai. I don't think that, there is a lot of confrontation between me and my husband right now. But it will fall under confrontation only, not domestic violence. This confrontation can be handled by clear, open communication. And right. Quickly revert. Revert back to your original self. That is the requirement for the new normal. Do not hang on to what we could do earlier. Do not hang on to negativity. Let it go faster than before. That is a suggestion for all of us tonight.
Yeah, correct, ma'am. I guess it was a very short lecture that you delivered, but still very effective, how to communicate to ourselves and the people around us. I think that was a very beautiful
learning. More questions, Sonia? We can ask the floor, like how Ramin came up, live question. Anyone other than the chat box, anyone, any question for Mahua? Any which way, she has left her email ID, so people are free to get in touch.
I think that's good because the other two speakers, I'm eagerly waiting to hear both of them. So thank you everybody for such a lovely opportunity. Yes.
Thank you so much, Mahua. Thanks for accepting our invite and sparing your time. I know how busy you are, especially in this virtual meetings and all. And good, you told me that we don't think from our heart. So next time you meet Manish, please tell him that yes, your wife does not cannot think from heart. She thinks from her mind.
Tell him. I will do that.
Tell that to Manish. Thank you so much, Mahua. Really, we are really, really blessed. Thank you so much. Pranya?
Yes, ma'am. Thank you so much, ma'am. I thank you for all the wonderful words and advices that you have given to the young members as well as all the other members of PRCI. So I guess we should now move on to our next speaker of the day. Just like our topic convergence, we have a very beautifully aligned set of speakers who are addressing both, how to deal with communication in the sphere of professional sphere and also on a personal level. So the third speaker for today we have is a very interesting one. She is none other than Taruna Torani. She's an anchor herself and a very, very beautiful profile she has. Now that Asudhir ma'am had covered a journalistic perspective from a very hard news point of view. Now we have Taruna Torani ma'am, who is from the entertainment angle. So I'll give it now to Anindita ma'am. She has more to say about Taruna ma'am.
Welcome, Taruna. Sorry.
Hi, Anindita. How are you?
We little overshot the earlier time, but you know how interesting it was. Whenever I could see when you joined hearing Uma and Mahua, we just couldn't miss anything. Of course, you cannot finish off everything. So here is Taruna. We call her, she is more famous and known as a celebrity anchor because she has interviewed more than 500 celebrities and Bollywood, Tollywood, and also Hollywood. In fact, she is only one of the journalists, entertainment anchor, who could go to US and, the US actor Jennifer and Chris Lawrence. She was the only journalist who had the interview of them. And I have seen her personally. She, came to our metro station. She does the live shoots here. Also, the fireside chats with celebrities. And immense. And of course, her profile, complete profile is there with all of you to go through it. So thank you so much, Taruna. Now we would love to hear from you, and especially yours is a zone very unique, and maybe people of communication who are thinking, the students rather, that which vertical to go under, maybe you can give a lead, because it's always glamour glitz, who really doesn't want that. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Anindita. great that you have invited me for this chat, and I think especially for the students who want to open avenues for entertainment journalism, I would really put some light on that. And firstly, when we think of entertainment journalism, the things that come to mind: glitz, glamour, fashion, grandeur, red carpets, premieres, all these things. And everybody wants to go and attend such events. But actually, what exactly it is? It is actually a big business. It is a big business. A film industry is really changing, and especially the likes of the consumers have been changing. And when we talk about convergence, we can see that there is not one platform for entertainment now. You can just, for the entertainment which actually was from print, television, radio, now has come on your smartphones. So nobody wants to only watch a cinema in theaters. They want to just open any app and they want to explore what new it is. So I think the convergence has content-wise, computing-wise, it has changed a lot over the years, because it's my 10th year in journalism. And I think entertainment industry has changed drastically. Now the question comes, how to get in? See, the thing is, whenever people see my photographs on Facebook or Insta with big celebrities, everybody wants to meet celebrities. But actually, what is journalism and what is meeting celebrities? There's a lot of difference. When it comes to journalism, there is a lot of study on it, research on it. It's not just going and taking selfies with them. And journalism in entertainment doesn't only have entertainment on screen. They need to know how to write, how to read the script, do some research on the celebrity. You just can't go and ask anything, because celebrity might feel bad about it. Or even if you want to ask direct and straightforward questions, you need to understand the subject first. So people say, isme kya entertainment hai, light hoga. But I think wo sabse heavy journalism hai. Kyunki first and foremost thing, you need to look at it as a visual dimension. You need to show everything very well visually, and then collaborate it with the writing, and then collaborate it with editing. So there is a lot of avenue, not on screen, but off screen also, for youngsters who are listening to this. You need to know what suits you. The thing is, when you see a video or anything on TV, you want to do that. But back end, there is a lot of work. You need to know how to write, how to read, how to do the video editing, the camera work. So there are a lot of avenues youngsters should explore. So first, understand what suits you. Be it OTT platform, what suits you. You have to plan well and then execute well. Start planning, not just listening to someone, or not even getting influenced by all the fancy photographs you see in newspapers. You have to understand which zone you want to get into. You want to get into a zone of writing, reading, or you want to do only voiceovers? Or you want to do something in the entertainment scenario where you can just even get into styling. So a lot of opportunities for youngsters that way. And it requires enormous years of experience to reach there, because a lot of kick-ass work, I can say, for all the youngsters there. It doesn't just come like that. But now that we have online smartphones, so they are really taking up a lot of youngsters to do a lot of work, which influences, you know, there is one more new journalism that's called influencers. Influencers are really doing well. So that will create your profile. Like Uma also said, you have to create your profile now. The television journalism is really growing. But now at this point, I feel digital journalism is much more ahead. Because see, before, when we used to get a interview 7 or 8 years back, that was exclusive interview. Now to do exclusive interview, we have to see that no smartphones are around us, because anybody who can click it, anybody can just record it and play it on their YouTube channel or maybe on their platform. So we have to be very smart that way. Fronia. You want to put some cues, Fronia?
Fronia? Unmute yourself.
I guess there's some network problem. Yes, ma'am, sorry.
So next, the questions, the next cue you want to give her, she's asking?
Yes, ma'am. There are a bunch of students who are from mass communication and journalism. I would like to
see Mr. Ramchander's question here.
Yes, ma'am. Hi. Having interviewed so many celebrities who are achievers, what did you learn from them? I guess
thank you so much, Ramchander ji. First and foremost thing, every celebrity has their own trait, has their own quality. The first thing I learned is always be spontaneous, because celebrities, whatever questions you ask them, they are very spontaneous about it, and they make themselves, they work on themselves. I'm not saying all celebrities are successful in doing it, but actually many celebrities whoever even fail, but it's okay to fail, it's all right. Youngsters, one thing I would like to say, that it's okay. First try, second try, third try, fourth try, you will succeed. So just don't give up that hope. That's what I learned from celebs.
Okay, ma'am. So I have another question asked in a personal chat. How are people in the media industry aligning their crafts to fit to the new convergent media and OTT audience? I guess this is specifically talking about celebrities and people who are already there, but how are they aligning their crafts to fit to the new media platforms?
Okay, firstly, you have to know the digital grasping power. You need to know all the techniques of the digital media, because digital media is growing so fast. Every new day you have a new technology. First, understand the technology and the content. First and foremost thing is, don't copy the content, be original. Try to be inclusive, but actually exclusive. Be inclusive, what people like, what the consumer wants to watch. But you need to understand that you have to be original. Don't compare yourself with some other digital media, or don't compare yourself with anybody. If some person is doing it, are uska video viral gaya, mera bhi jayega. There is no rule in entertainment. So you have to be very original.
Right, ma'am. Taking another question from the chat. What is the difference that you see as a news anchor and while interviewing celebrities? How is it different? What are the different specific different skill sets?
Yeah. So first thing is, as I told you, you have to do a lot of research. In entertainment, the major difference is you need not go to the history. The present content is only the selling content. But when it comes to news, you have to understand the stories before that and then before that. In entertainment, you can actually, with the editing, with the graphics, you can make it more interesting.
Correct. There's another question here in the chat, ma'am. What is your secret for managing to get so many interviews? I guess this is your question.
That secret, I think I can't share with you guys. No, I'm just kidding. Firstly, there is no secret. The problem is what, you know, once you're successful, people start asking you tips, kya hai, secret, kya hai? Nothing, only originality. Be yourself. Don't copy people. If you're seeing some anchor, if you're seeing somebody on screen, you feel that, are iski tarah hona hai. No, don't do that. You understand what is your USP. You understand what are your qualities. Enhance those qualities. You must be having your own strengths. Enhance those strengths. That's it. That's the secret.
Yes, ma'am. And having you live here, I guess it would be wrong on our part if we let you out without asking. How was it different? How was your experience when you went ahead there and interviewed the Hollywood celebrities? How was it different from interviewing the Bollywood?
Yeah, that was a dream come true, because from whole of South India, I was the only person going to Hollywood. So I can say that was like a dream. And when I went, I worked with the Hollywood team itself, the camera team and everybody. See, the one thing I understood is worldwide media, the kind of passion, everybody has the same passion. I met all the journalists from different parts of the world and everything was same. But the only difference which I saw is here, there is a lot of emotional quotient. When you meet a celebrity, oh, hi, how are you? And a lot of emotional quotient, because you are from the same place. But when it comes to Hollywood, they're more subtle. They're more straightforward. If they don't like something, they'll tell it on the face. They're not diplomatic at all.
Yes, ma'am. And I guess you answered pretty much questions of how to venture into the... Yes, there's another question from Ramindra,
yeah,
sir.
Yeah.
Yes, sir.
So, Taruna, that was a great way of explaining the being inclusive and yet being exclusive. not only for the youngsters but also for grandfathers like me. Right?
So my welcome question grandfather.
My question to you is,
yeah, tell me
that in your journey, which has been the most critical, vital or challenging moment and why?
Yeah, good question. So basically, most challenging I can say when Mr. Amitabh Bachchan was in Hyderabad for his shooting for Sarkar 2, and we had to get into the on location. We had to do. So entertainment journalism, we need a lot of permissions to do any shooting, even a small shooting, because there is a lot of protocol, there's a lot of security inside. And then we had to get inside. And means you need to have a lot of network to get there. If your network is good, if your profile is good, fine. But if your network is good, it adds to it. So when I explained it to them that I want to shoot with Mr. Bachchan, I had to wait for almost 6 hours. And later on, I was okay with it because it was Mr. Amitabh Bachchan. So I thought, okay, I can. And then when I went inside, he was very, pleasant and welcoming. And then we started doing, so I think that 5 minutes of interview has added, and one more interview, Mr. Shah Rukh Khan. I can tell about Shah Rukh that he had actually come to a very big mall, and we went inside the mall. Everybody was fighting to take a selfie. And when I went inside, I straightforwardly, as I told you, it was not diplomacy. It was totally originality. I told him, see, I've interviewed all the Khans, but if I interview you, it'll add to my profile. And he just quickly agreed to it. I didn't keep a face saying that, no, I'm from so and so channel and all. I just told him it will add to my profile. And I just like your acting. He said, "Theek hai, andar aajo." And I did 8 minutes of interview where he sang, he spoke, he interacted so well that was the most exclusive interview which was played on TV9 network, like all the networks from Hyderabad, Gujarat and other networks too. So I think these two interviews were like my life changing. After that, they put me full time into entertainment.
Great. Wonderful.
Thank you.
Congratulations.
Thank you so much.
I guess there's a lot of color and blitz in your talk, ma'am. And I guess stories like this will go on because interviewing so many celebrities, I'm sure there must be a story behind every celebrity that you interviewed.
Absolutely.
So here's another question before we conclude on your note, ma'am. Now that you spoke about the different levels that you need to cross and go before interviewing a celebrity, you have very short time, like you said, 5 minutes, 8 minutes. You know, how do you manage to package your content, or, you know, what do you put first and what do you take next? You know, because though it is short, you want to keep it interesting and entertaining. How do you do that?
Very good question.
Yeah, very good question. I was about to say that. So first and foremost thing is you should know what's the lead. When you go, it's not like preparing 10 questions and asking it. Understand the news angle of it. Entertainment has a news angle. Many people say entertainment is all about glitz and glamour. Yes, of course, but it has a news angle. Just understand the news angle and what is the news angle the celebrity would like to talk as well as you want to ask. Sometimes celebrities are not so open enough to talk, but still it's your art, it's your talent, how to get that kind of chunk of information from the celeb. So the lead which you have in mind, just program it that way in the mind. Ask the celebrity, talk to them. And I feel that celebrities are also humans, of course. So they would also be interested to talk to you if your lead is good, if it is informative and entertaining too.
Absolutely, ma'am. Thank you so much for those wonderful tips. I guess a lot of students who are here must have been inspired from what you and your stories and your encounters, and I guess they also will take on to learning something from you and becoming something, because now you said that everything is different. People have to make their own niche, being exclusive in an inclusive world, something like that, in the world of convergence. So I guess everybody had something to learn from you, even the new ones and also the existing professionals. Thank you so much, ma'am. Thank you so
thank
much.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
And on the concluding note, do you have anything to say to the upcoming student journalists?
Yeah. So don't see the glitz and glamour and those red carpet events and think that you have to enter into entertainment journalism. Just immerse yourself, just swim into it, the information, because if you really love it, if you passionately love it, you would do it. Otherwise, you would get bored after a few events or few interviews. If you really want to get into it, swim into it. And if you fail, it's okay. you should try again and you should succeed.
Sure, ma'am. Thank you so much for those lovely words. And that was a very, very bright and that was an entertaining session, just like your reports otherwise. Thank you
thank
so
you.
Much.
Thank you.
Thank you so much, Taruna. Thanks a lot. Hearing Shahrukh Khan, I was about to think that let me change my line. But when you said I have to wait for 6 to 8 hours to meet a big celebrity, I thought, no, I'm good.
You are already an influencer for many people. And I think everybody will agree here. You already influence so many people. You are no less than Shahrukh Khan.
That's my friend's kindness, like you and Uma. Thank you so much. Our metro is starting from 7, so please come with the celebrities again.
Oh, absolutely.
Thank you so much, Taruna. Thanks for accepting our invite, being there and spending your time. We got little date, so delayed, so I will apologize. But you understand.
No, not at all. I totally understand. It happens when waiting for a celebrity, so I have a lot of patience for that.
Thank you so much, Taruna. Love you. Thank you so much.
Love you too.
Good night. Please be there. So with this, we go to our next very vibrant and dynamic speaker, Danek Kanakraj. You have read his profile. How he became an achiever. He is a motivational coach, a soft skill trainer by profession. I mean, he was an electronic and communication engineer by education and passionate trainer, winner of very prestigious awards like Rajendra Prasad Leadership Award and Vision 2020 by APJ Abdul Kalam Award, a TEDx speaker. And I will not speak anything more for Danesh. Danesh, the floor is yours. Just go inspire the youngsters and say how it is one should be an achiever, not to be down so easily in life. We are seeing cases of succumbing to failures. No, life is not really so low and down and dark. Over to you, Danesh. Thank you so much for being there. Please go ahead.
Thank you so much for the opportunity, Anindita ma'am. So I thank everybody for staying so late and listening to me. I will just take 7 to 8 minutes, not more than that. I assure you that. So world of convergence and communication through convergence. We are all talking about convergence through the medium of convergence called Zoom. So that itself defines everything. So Fronia, can you please share the screen? So something is happening in the ecosystem which is hammering us, or something which is having a paradigm shift in the world that we are getting into, which was already existing, but it is called as a complicated world. And today, where we are getting into is a complex world. So there are two metaphors, and I would like to explain to you these two metaphors with these two favorite games of mine. One is chess. How many of you like chess? Please put in the chat box. And I too love chess. Now chess, if you want to open the game in a chess, there are dozens of ways to open up a chess. Four moves into the game, you have close to 70 combinations. 14 moves, you have close to 70,000 combinations. And 20 steps or 20 moves into the game, you are playing a game which was never ever played before. Considering the complexity of the game, the knights move in a certain direction, the caliphate moves in a certain direction, and every goes in a certain direction. But to say that in an experienced chess player can definitely defeat a less experienced player. Now that is how the complicated world, the philosophy of complicated world and the environment is. And I would like to quote another example for complicated world called assembly line. Now Frederick is a founder for assembly line. Now assembly line is nothing but, if you want to produce a product, there are several things that are integrated together and put across as a product. So if you give everything to one person, they are not able to do it much better. If you divide the entire assembly line into different sections, And if you give one part to another, one second part to second, third part to second, third, the channel or the link that they have is completely very easy to do. And the kind of product that you get at the end of the day is quite very fast. And after certain practices, you get that fastness also. So because of that assembly line, the growth is not about incremental growth. It is about exponential growth. Well, this is about the complicated world, the complicated environment that we are in, which we have already been there. Now we are getting into something called as complex world, which you are already traveling into. Next slide, please. This is again one of my best game or a favorite game called snooker. Now snooker, ironically, has 10 coins for 10 balls lesser than chess. Snooker has 22 balls and chess has 32. Look, if I ask a world-class player to open this game with a certain stroke, you know, the player will open it. But if I ask the same person for the same world-class player to open the game with the same kind of stroke, none of the world-class player can do that. Because even if you have the slightest stroke difference of even of 1 micron, the resultant board will not be the same. And that is the kind of complex world where we are. But if you ask a world-class player to pot the ball, he'll definitely pot for you. But he cannot guarantee you the result, how the resultant board will be. Exactly is our situation also. We are so much focused, we are so much goal-oriented, dream-oriented. We want to pot the ball, but then we do not know what is the kind of resultant goal that we can get at the end of the day when we play a game of life, or the play of game of life, dreams, career, passion, everything. We need to consider this game of snooker when we choose anything that we want to do in our lives. Because the same player cannot be playing the same game tomorrow. Exactly same person like me and you cannot be living the same life today and tomorrow. It has to be different, and we need to consider those lives to be a new, every day to be a new day, every journey to be a new journey, and every step to a new step. Because we cannot count on our experiences that we had from past 2 years or 3 years or 1 decade or 2 decades. Because the environment is already complex. We need to become more and more self-aware. My submission here is, you know, we need to become more and more self-aware. We need to treat every day as a new day and challenge every day, or treat every day as a new day, in order to achieve our dreams and goals that we have in front of the board. Because the resultant force or the resultant board that you're looking at will not be likewise that we are aiming for. And when the resultant board is not like that you are aiming for, you have another day which is there for you when you can come up and achieve what you're aiming at. So self-awareness and commitment is my submission for the day. Thank you so much. And thank you, Anandita ma'am, for the opportunity, and the Surashri Bharaji and Mahua ma'am for referring me.
Thank you so much, sir. I guess in as much short message that you have delivered, that was a very, very powerful one. From the analogies that you took, though they were very simple, I guess there's a lot of learning that we have to take from your analogies. Thank you so much for your time, sir. And now I would like to open the floor for any questions from the audience for sir. Please unmute yourself and go ahead and ask the questions.
Oh, brilliant. No questions.
No, we have right. one in the chat, a personal chat. So,
what is that? Why? What is this? Nowadays youngsters are very impatient about things around. What is that one thing you would like to give them as a message? How to cope up with downfalls in life?
There are two things. One is result and another one is reasons. Now, I would like to give you the options to you, whether you want to choose results or whether you want to choose reasons. If you choose results, don't just look up at only results, because results could be success or could be failure. Now, again, there is an option there. But then what we have in our hand is a process and the kind of effort and the commitment that we give to the process. Because in one day, the Rome is not built in one day. The kingdom is not built in one day. Because it is up to you, how do you take the process ahead? It is the commitment and the effort that you put into the process. Today I'm here delivering my, I didn't call this as a talk or something like that, but as a chat. But earlier I have delivered almost close to 185 talks, out of which 5 are my prestigious TEDx talks. Now, I wouldn't have come to this space of nearing towards the second century, creating a double century in my talking, on my speaking engagement journey. I believed in process from day one to day 190. It is the process and the effort that we can put into, and that is what the commitment means.
Yes, sir, we have another question for you. With communication being fragmented now and everybody communicating through online and social media platforms, it is difficult to see people around us face to face. So with a lot of suicidal tendencies developing amongst many youth, how is it that we identify these from people even in the digital world? How do we identify and how do we get to them?
So I do not know how do we get to them, but then if there is a problem like this way, I'm sure which could be tackled with psychologists. My area is into motivation, soft skill training and business storytelling. So if you can cover or if you can put me questions on these three things, that would be better.
Oh. Yes, so there's another one. Sir, there are a lot of times that we keep trying for success, but we fail many times. What are the tips that you give to boost our morale?
So again, the same thing, effort comes in and the process and the commitment that we give. But then I don't want to just give out the words that are being repeated again and again, the effort, process and commitment. Let me give you a short narrative to you, because that will clear out the entire doubt and I will achieve the objective by telling you that narrative to you. 2015, I got graduated from my college and I was hospitalized in Kerala for 4 months. I was completely in the four walls of the room. I had nothing to do, but my fellow members got job, they were kind of settling into job and everything. It was quite depressing for me, and I had nothing to do in the four walls of the room. And I had a laptop, mobile phone, and the internet connection. What I started to do is I started to write. I started to write the life experiences, the college experiences, my learnings, my challenges, everything. Today my blog has close to 2,900 followers. Now that is not important. Now what is important here is this blog gave me an opening to a complete new world of speaking industry, speaking engagement, and becoming a motivational speaker. The first talk, I had never been an con stage, con engagement, never been anywhere. And the first stage that I got was TEDx. And mind you, that stage was quite daunting for me. I had completely mucked up 18 minutes of my talk, mucked up my 18 minutes of my talk as a cancer. And I literally went onto the stage, forgot the entire speech in front of 250-300 people. And I did all I did. And, you know, getting that humiliation in front of 250 people and virtually on YouTube channel of TEDx, that went global platform, close to 20 million followers. You look at the humiliation that I would have faced, or that any speaker would have faced. But today, again, I tell you, I repeat my point, that it is close to 190th engagement or 190th speaking engagement. It is only possible because of the zeal, of the commitment, or the effort that you put into the process of learning something very passionately. What I have hidden, that I am a person with disability, and I am at 74, I have 74% of disability. My four limbs in the sense, my both the hands and both the legs doesn't work in the sense, there's a little bit of functionality deficiency. But I crisscross, travel across the country to motivate, inspire, and motivate the students, youth, and people across, do that. The only thing that I believe in is commitment, effort, in the systematic approach to anything that you can.
Thank you so much, sir. I guess more than your talk, I guess you yourself are an example of how people must get most motivate themselves to move forward in this time. On a personal note, sir, there's another question. Since you are a blogger yourself, I would like you to answer this. Now, given that everybody is moving rampantly to social media, there's a lot of content in place. What do you think are necessary, or what are the qualities that one must inculcate to, sell their blogs or to make their blogs stand out in this virtual space?
Before getting into selling or into the business point of it, I have never got into business point of my blogging because I can monetize that, but I never did that because I love journaling. I love to write whatever has happened in the day to day. Like when you start journaling, whatever your experiences are, your activities that you have done, the challenges that you have faced, what are the kind of successes that you have achieved, that becomes a record for yourself in order to share stories in the later part of the system or the later part of the cages. Because today when I share stories about myself and inspire people, it is not just that, I write it today. I start doing it from the day one, and I can share my stories, and I can share the blogs that I write as an experience, as a learning echo to everybody in order to motivate them. Now coming to blogging, if you want to do something in the blogging, the thing, journalism, journaling is the key to success. And journaling, again, it is not very easy to do. And what is so easy to do, it is not so, what is so tough to do is not so easy to do. And what is so easy to do is not tough to do. So that is my submission.
I would like to ask a question.
Very well, sir. Yes,
Ramin has a question for you. Ramin has a question.
Yeah, Danish, that was a really inspirational talk. And you have given a wonderful analogy from the field of chess. So I used to play a little bit, and my favorite piece is the horse, because that's the only one which can jump. Suppose you were to draw an analogy between life strategies and a horse or any of the favorite pieces, what would it be and why?
That's a really good question. Nobody has asked me, but I need time to ponder upon it. But then, yeah, horse is a good, you know, this thing to jump upon. I would connect horse analogy with opportunity.
Excellent.
Right? So, if you get an opportunity, never lose out on it. Definitely go jump upon it. Even if you do not know it, it's absolutely fine. Jump upon it, know the traits of it. You'll fail one or twice, and then on the third time or the fourth time, you'll definitely succeed. So never let out opportunity, never lose any kind of opportunity that you have in your hand.
Thank you. That was brilliant. That was absolutely brilliant.
Thank you so much for putting me on spot.
Absolutely.
Ramin can do that. Prony, any
thank you questions? So much, sir. No, ma'am, as of now, I don't think there are any more questions. But I guess I'll have to thank Dani sir again for his time, because it's indeed our pleasure to have somebody who has delivered talks on TEDx to be amidst us to give life learning experiences to our young journalists, not just the young students, but also professionals who are already into their fields, well-versed in their fields. I think motivation is something that everybody needs to have on a personal basis, that we need to motivate ourselves before anybody else does. And I guess just like all the other three speakers of today said that before even selling ourselves or showing ourselves to the audience out there, it is important that we create. And that is when everything else will fall in place. I once again thank you so much, sir. Thank you for the time. Thank you for sparing it. So as we come to the conclusion of this webinar, I now like to open the court for anybody say something, would like to comment or ask questions. You are free to do so. Please unmute yourself and you can.
All our people are there. Jairam sir is there. The zonal national council members are there. The chapter heads are there. The members are there. So please free to have, you know, give a few messages or give good words on this Teachers' Day, because you all are mentors and all are teachers, such senior people. Vinay sir is there. Whoever I can see on the screen, please, some message from the members.
I'm here. I'm listening to all. I think Mr. Somebody wanted to speak. I was just thinking. Our man from Kerala.
You forgot my name,
Sundar. Sundar, man. Sundaram.
Yeah. I just was feeling that today's program was really excellent. Every student will become a teacher one day, and every teacher. Vice versa. I think a lot of disturbance is there. I don't
know.
Yes, sir. Now it's muted, sir. You can continue.
Yeah. So everyone can teach someone something, and everyone can learn from somebody something or the other. That's what I wanted to convey. Teachers' Day, today being Teachers' Day, I think it is, teachers are the real gurus. And everyone can become a guru one day or the other. Thank you.
Thank you so much.